Hey, it's Tomori here. Welcome to the last episode of my tutorial series about making a farm game in Unity, also known as making HayDay. Yes, you heard me right, this is the last one. We developed quite a few features during the whole series and the time has finally come to end it. In this episode, we will bring server saving to our game and develop a system that allows visiting other players. You asked me about this and here it is. Some of you actually doubted that I can make this, but I did. To recap, in the previous episode we developed a saving system that uses files to save the player information. We're going to be working on the same project that we used before, so if you haven't seen the previous episodes, go check them out. And if you want to skip rewriting code, you can support me on Patreon and get the source code along with the project files. But before we do this, this video is sponsored by LootLocker.
This is a game backend tool that allows you to create leaderboards, save player progression, and manage assets and DLCs. With LootLocker, you will be able to create assets, send announcements to players, and give different rewards without the need to actually update the game. It works with all the popular game engines like Unity, Unreal, Godot, etc., and also with different gaming platforms. In addition to existing cool features, the LootLocker team is constantly working on new ones and releasing updates. They have an amazing support team that helps game devs integrate this tool into games, and they actually listen to the user feedback. Throughout our interaction, they have added a couple of features that I needed to make the system for this episode.
I definitely recommend checking out this amazing tool and finally bring your game online. Follow the link in the description to get LootLocker for free right now.
So, how does this actually work? After the previous episode, we have a save file with player's progression that we're going to upload to LootLocker at runtime. This is going to be a public file, but a player can also have private ones. I recommend setting up two save files, one private for saving all the player's progress and preventing cheating, and one public for visitors where you can put only a part of the info. Now, the way that we're going to get access to those files is through a leaderboard. Every player will be added to it with a default score, but you can actually calculate it based on something like the number of buildings, level, etc. It is going to be displayed in the game and each player will have a visit button, and if it is pressed, it'll get all the player files. Find the right one and download it. Then a new scene is going to be loaded, and the same way that we load the player map at the beginning of the game, we're going to be loading the neighbor's map. And that's it, let's write some code. The first thing that we're going to do is set up LootLocker. Register an account, which is super easy. Then create a game. When you first register, it already prompts you to create your first game, and you can choose to explore a pre-made game to see what features are available and how to use them. Next, go to their GitHub page. You can do it from their main website page. Copy the URL from the LootLocker SDK, then go to your Unity project, package manager, and hit plus in the top left corner and choose add from git URL. Paste the URL that you copied and wait until it imports. Now, to actually connect the game that you created in your LootLocker account to your Unity project, you need to go to project settings, find LootLocker tab, and here you have the API key and domain key. Go to your LootLocker game page, settings, and under the API tab, find these two values. You shouldn't share these keys with anyone. Copy them and paste into the corresponding fields in your Unity project. Now, you're all set with the SDK, go to your LootLocker game page, go to Systems, Leaderboards, and create your first leaderboard. Give it a name, a key for easier access from code, and then check Enable Game API right so you can actually submit the score's runtime. And I'm also checking the override score on submit because I wanted to reflect the current score of the player and not the highest. That's all we have to do on the website, we can move on to Unity. First, let me show you the UI we need for this system. I have this window for displaying the leaderboard. It just has a few text objects and buttons. I also have an input field for the name, but we're not going to be using this in this tutorial. But I'll make sure to include this part on my Patreon. This UI has a scroll view for all the players from the leaderboard. Each player has a visit button and also have this like button, which can be used to add people to your friends. Yes, I said that the friend system is currently in development, but there is a way to set it up right now. And you can find it on the LootLocker blog. Another UI object that we need is an end screen. You know that every game has an end screen that pops up when you want to exit the game? And that's not just for the player to stay in the game, that's also to save the progress. So I made a simple screen with two buttons that just says close your game. First, create a folder called Server Saving in Scripts folder. Create new scripts called Player Manager, Social Manager and Neighborhood Manager. So before we get further into coding, you need to know that in every script that you want to use LootLocker, you need to write usingLootLocker.regress before the class declaration. Generally, LootLocker functions are called like this. They are called on LootLocker SDK Manager and they have an action onComplete as a parameter. That's where you should check if that response was successful and then do other things if it was. And I also recommend writing an else, and if the response wasn't successful, you would print out a message and the error. But for the sake of this tutorial, I'm going to be working with the response success block, so the code isn't too long. The first script is player manager. It is going to have a public int player ID with a get and a private set. Then we have a string player identifier with a get and a private set. These are not the same actually. One is an ID that LootLocker gives the player and the other one is the device identifier, used to start the LootLocker session. Next, create a public bool called player logged in. Next, write a method called start session. This is the first thing that you want to do when working with LootLocker. In it, get the identifier first by calling the system info device unique identifier. Next, call LootLocker SDK manager, the method start session. Pass the player identifier and set up the response callback. In it, check if the response is a success. If so, get the player ID from the response. And set the player logged in bool to true. Now create a string variable player name, which is going to be player and a random number between 1 and say 10,000. Call the LootLocker SDK manager, set player name, pass the name and an empty response. Next, move on to the social manager script. First, create a public static string file path. It is going to be used to save the neighbor file path. Next, write a serialized field of type game object called social panel. This is the whole panel with a leaderboard. Write another serialized field game object called friend entry prefab. This is a prefab for all the player entries in the leaderboard. And a serialized field transform for the content from the scroll view. Then, we also need a serialized field for the player manager. After this, I'm creating a string field to store the leaderboard key. Make sure that you initialize it with the right name. Another string that I'm declaring is called save file purpose. So each player file in LootLocker has some kind of purpose. It is stored in capital letters, so make sure that it actually matches. In the awake method, initialize the file path. I'm going to be getting the application data path or actually use the persistent data path like we did in the previous episode about saving. Then create a coroutine called setup routine. First call the player manager, start session, and then write yield return new, wait while, lambda, and wait for the player manager, player logged in, equals false. So basically we're waiting for the player session to start so the LootLocker starts and we don't get any errors. Next, call the LootLocker SDK manager submit score method. Pass the player ID from the player manager and also call toString on it because it is an integer. As a score, we'll use the default one and then an empty response. But as you remember, I highly recommended checking for success and printing out everything went well or there was an error. In the start method, call start coroutine and pass the setup routine. Next, we're going to be writing the methods starting with the last one and then working our way up. So the first one is an IEnumerator called visitNeighbor that accepts a string savefile URL. This will just help us download the file with map data. In it, create a Unity web request variable and initialize it with UnityWebRequest.get and pass the URL. You'll return www.sendRequest. Then call file, write all text, pass the file path and get the download handler text from the web request. Then just call the asset database refresh so the file actually shows up in the assets. You'll return new, wait for seconds, and pass just 0.1 because it's gonna be really quick. And then call the scene manager load scene and pass the name neighbor scene. The scene manager is from Unity, so if you have it highlighted red, you just need to import it. Then we currently don't have the neighbor scene, but we're gonna create it soon. Next, create a method called getSaveData, which accepts an int player ID. In it, call LootLocker SDK manager, get all player files, pass the player ID, and in the response check if it is successful. Then create variable player files and initialize it with the response items. It is an array of LootLocker player files, but instead of writing the type, I just put var so it's quicker. Get the save file. You do this by calling first or default on the player files and looking for the file that has the same file purpose. After this, check if it is not null and start the coroutine called visit neighbor. As a parameter, pass save file URL that you get from that file that you found in the array. That's it for this method. The next method is called initialize leaderboard UI, and it returns void and accepts an array of LootLocker leaderboard members. It goes through each member, gets the player from it, saves it in a variable, instantiates display prefabs for them, and initializes the name and adds a listener to that visit button. In it, call getSaveData and pass the player ID. Next, we have another method called getLeaderboard. First, create two ints called count and after. There are just limits for the leaderboard, so we're getting members from 0 to 50. Call LootLocker SDK manager, get score list, pass the leaderboard key, count, after, and in the response check for success, as usual, and get the items from it. They will be leaderboard members, an array of them. Call initialize leaderboard UI and pass these items. And finally, go to the setup routine that we created earlier and call getLeaderboard method at the end. Now, moving on to the method called createSave. First, we have to get rid of the previous save file, so we don't end up with a gazillion files and we just have one that is up to date. For that, call LootLocker SDK manager get all player files. In the response, check for success. Then get all the player files just like we did before. Go through all of them and check their purpose. If it matches the save file purpose that we have saved, then we have to call the LootLocker SDK manager, delete player file, and pass the ID of that file you found. Again, response is empty, but check if it was successful and print something out. After this block, just write LootLocker SDK manager, upload player file, pass the file path from the save system, save file purpose, true to indicate that this file is public and other players can access it, and a response. Now, for the other methods, I just have these two simple ones for opening and closing the whole leaderboard window. It's actually called the social panel here. Next up is the neighborhood manager. It is similar to the game manager because it loads the data from the file, so I'm not gonna be writing it line by line, just explain what's going on. So first, in the start method, we're loading the neighbor file and getting the actual save data object from it. Then we load the map. This is exactly the same method that we have in the game manager. If you're having an error with shop items path, don't worry, you just need to make it public static field. And at the end, I have this simple void return for the button so the player can return back to their own map. Now we're done with the main code and we need to connect things. First, create two empty game objects. One for the player manager and one for the social manager. Attach corresponding scripts to them. Player manager doesn't have any fields to fill in. Social manager needs the social panel, the one with the leaderboard UI, a front entry prefab, that UI object with the player name and visit button. Then find the social content in the scroll view. And finally, add the player manager. Now connect the buttons for opening the social panel and the close button on it. Now, you have to create the neighborhood scene. The way I did it is actually by duplicating the scene files in the files. Then I opened the copied scene and cleaned up all the unnecessary files. I left the grid, event system, building system, and also a button for going home. And I created an empty game object for the neighborhood manager. Attach the script to it. Connect the home button. Now go to the game manager and create a field of type social manager and a game object close panel. Write a method called close game. In it, set active the end game panel. Call the same system save. And then call the social manager create save. Then write a method confirm close, which is going to call the application.quit. And then create a method confirm cancel. In it, disable the end game panel. In the update method, check for the input of the escape key. If it was pressed, call method close the game. Now go to the editor and connect these buttons. Yes means quit the game, no means cancel quit. Finally, we can test if everything works. When you first start the game, your leaderboard is empty, so you have to press escape to actually save the file on the server side. When you start again, you're gonna see that you've got one entry and this is the same player. That's okay, since it is the only player that we have in our entire game. But the thing is, the system can be tested with this because of how things are set up. When you hit visit, the map successfully loads. The only problem is that every time you start the game, your name changes, and that's because we set our code this way. So let's go to the player manager, and instead of just setting the name every time, we're gonna get the player name using LootLocker and then check if it is empty. Only then we will generate the player name. And if we go to the LootLocker website, we can see the player on the leaderboard we created earlier, and also you can see the player. And we can also see the save file we uploaded. Everything works, so we're done!
With LootLocker, you will be able to recreate a lot of multiplayer features that you can see in simulation games like HayDay. You can let your players have the same account on different devices, set up player visitations, as we did in this video. And the good news is, the LootLocker team is already working on a friends and clans system. So if you want me to continue working with LootLocker and showing you these amazing cool features, let me know by hitting the like button and writing comments. And thank you for watching! This is the last episode of Making HayDay, but this is not my last video about simulation games like HayDay. I will be working on new projects very soon and bring you more useful content. So subscribe to my channel and turn on the notifications to not miss out on my new videos. Also, I'd like to thank all my patrons for supporting me and welcome new members, especially
Ruben, Game Library, Jacob Duckman, Emre Teskin, Nico, Mateo Lopez, Tudor Droboda.
See you in the next video! Bye!